gathered together from the cosmic reaches of the universe. Here, in this great hall of the Signal Watch, are the most powerful forces of good ever assembled. Join us as we discuss all manner of topics across the multiverse of comic books, history, creators, storylines, movies, and more. The Signal Watch podcast presents Kryptonian Thought Beast, a comics podcast series dedicated to truth, justice, and peace for all mankind. Hey everybody, and welcome back to the Signal Watch. As always, I'm your host, Ryan Steens, and with me today is
Jamie.
And we have recently watched
Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness. Multiverse. I said multiverse.
Multiverse.
I don't know what that is. Multiverse.
So
yeah, we're a little bit delayed. We're still at the disadvantage of having to watch all of these things when they come to Disney Plus, which this needs to be seen in theater.
Yeah,
I feel like I missed a lot visually.
Yeah,
yeah.
You didn't want to just scoot closer to the TV.
I mean, I feel like that was the strongest part of the movie almost. Because there was, I don't want to say I was disappointed. There are other Marvel movies that I liked a lot more.
What disappointed you? What did you feel was the weak part?
Well, okay, so as I said when we covered Doctor Strange, he as a character just doesn't grab me.
Uh-huh.
And I thought when he was together with other people, it was a lot better.
Uh-huh.
He was like a side character. And I thought maybe because this one has more characters, because he's been established, I wouldn't have that problem. But I kind of had that problem again. He's not someone that I care that much about. I don't mind Benedict Cumberbatch as an actor. I just find this character not that interesting. And I found the characters around him a lot more interesting.
Uh-huh.
But he has to drive the movie. I mean, here's an example. They introduced a new character, America Chavez. We learned almost nothing about her backstory through the entire movie. And she is very important to the plot.
Right.
And I can't help but think they will be using her in the future. I mean, they kept her around. There's no reason to believe that she won't be. And maybe they'll explore that then. But anyway, I don't know.
Okay.
I was just a little disappointing. Also, and then I'll let you speak. I'm so sorry.
Okay.
I felt like they took, and I won't even call her Wanda, because she was the Scarlet Witch in this. From the end of WandaVision, they took her like three steps back. I felt like all the lessons she learned from creating this false reality and destroying these people's lives, and she goes and now she wants to destroy her other self from the other multiverse, like, and kill a bunch of people in the process. Like, what is that about? Ryan, explain it to me.
So you also managed not to get spoiled somehow.
I did. So this was, yeah, this hit me a little harder probably than if I had been spoiled. I knew nothing about this movie, which is a miracle because I'm on Twitter.
Yeah. So I feel like talking about the movie and its plot is almost pointless in some ways. I feel like this movie was intended to do a bunch of things to push us towards what will happen. For one of the things that becomes truer and truer as you become more familiar with comics is eventually you can start to see the machinery of what's happening with the company and what they're doing with stories.
And I feel like we've definitely hit that part with the MCU. I don't mind. I mean, it's just part of how all of this stuff works. But the you can watch it as a story. It's a wizard battle movie.
Indeed.
And so at some point, everything becomes a lot of special effects and abstractions. I do think this movie did it in ways that I found totally different from the first Doctor Strange and very enjoyable to watch. I'm not telling you to do drugs. But if you do...
Did you feel like you wanted to drop acid before this movie?
I mean, no, I don't. But it... I think it was a really fun movie. I think it was like... It did all the things that happen in like a Doctor Strange comic book. Like in the magic side of the Marvel U. This is just what magic bearing comics look like. Like, and it's part of why I was coming up much more of a like X-Men, which is really concrete and they're outsiders living among humanity, and Batman, and you know, later got into Superman and all that. Magic stuff I like in really small doses, and a 2-hour Doctor Strange movie, chef's kiss, perfect amount. and then I'm out. I'm kind of the same way about a lot of cosmic stuff. Like I I'm not that interested in an ongoing series about Silver Surfer, but I'll, you know, I care about the Silver Surfer enough. And so, but I do think that there's a lot of machinery that goes on in the comics that you can see what editorial's doing, and I think that's true here as well. Marvel is setting itself up to have both its next generation of heroes, and they're, you know, they've already kind of bridged the gap with Captain Marvel. There will be the Monica Rambeau version of Captain Marvel, mm-hmm. which will be Photon or whatever she's calling herself this week. And we have Ms. Marvel now. So we kind of have the three legacies right there.
Right.
America Chavez has appeared in the comics alongside characters like Ms. Marvel. And so they're kind of setting it up to have like a Teen Titans sort of something that will appear alongside whatever the Avengers or whatever they end up calling the team. You know, as things go along, they're exploiting a lot of stuff that's I never thought you'd ever see in a movie. Or Mount Wendigore is one of those things that, like, if you read Marvel Comics, sooner or later, Mount Wendigore shows up one way or another.
Is that where she was at the end?
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's all tied in with like Morgan Le Fay and like crazy stuff going back to like the 6th century, and it's I don't really remember. I'm trying to tap brain cells from reading the like who's who guides or whatever, the Marvel handbooks from like when I was in middle school. But like Wanda's original history was much different and included like a cow lady who raised her, and I think I've talked about that before on the podcast, but it gets crazy, right? It's because it's comics. Right. And I don't know if any of that's true in the comics anymore, but the other thing is, by the way, spoilers, whatever, get out now if you haven't seen the movie, but Wanda routinely goes crazy in the comics and wreaks havoc. That's just her thing. She's a good guy who's super powerful, who occasionally goes nuts, and...
Well, okay, that's havoc. Fair enough. But I wish they had shown that. Because the last we saw of her, she was... It reminded me of the end of Incredible Hulk. When he was like, I'm a danger to people, I'm going to go put myself in the woods.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what she did at the end of WandaVision.
Yeah.
And she was studying.
Yeah.
So that's the last we saw of her.
Yeah. And
beginning of this, he goes to Doctor Strange goes to see her and all seems well, and then she, haha, I have turned evil and I want to go be with my kids in the other multiverse.
How long was this movie?
2 hours.
Right. So I think the problem is, and this is plagued Marvel since the beginning, like I would have liked way more Captain America of Chris Evans. And you know, we basically, by Captain America 3, we're not having a Captain America movie. We're having an Avengers movie called Captain America. And I think that that would have been an interesting story to see happen. But instead, they didn't really have time for whatever else they're doing.
Yeah.
And
just from someone that does not familiar with the comics or the character,
yeah,
it seemed really jarring to me to have that happen.
I'm not disagreeing. Okay. I'm talking much more about what I think happened.
Okay.
You know, I had been spoiled on it. So I was like, oh, they're already going here when it happened in the first 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, I was like, well, if it's going to happen, at least now we're, you know, on the road. We're not going to do a thing where she's, like, sneaking around. I'm doing the, like, sneaking miming right now, you know, behind Doctor Strange, like, making stuff happen or, like, the big reveal at the end.
Yeah.
Instead, we know what the problem is and we're going to just deal with it.
Yeah.
And this is kind of why I think this movie is more of, like, a stopgap for the Marvel U than it is a legit movie. Like, they needed to get some things done.
Yeah, it felt more so than the other... And I say this having seen the other Marvel movies, like, more than one time each. Like, when we went back and rewatched them, I knew the whole story. So, I might be remembering them incorrectly in that I was able to see where they were going,
mm-hmm,
in each of them. And I could not tell in this where we're going from this. What this is setting up Marvel to do.
Yeah.
Like, if it's setting... Because it feels like the other movies are all part of a big puzzle piece. Or all puzzle pieces.
Yeah.
And this I couldn't tell. And I mean... Part of it may be intentional. I mean, that's not necessarily a bad thing that you don't know where the story is going. But I had heard that this was supposed to come out before Spider-Man at one point. And then so they had to kind of rewrite because they used the Doctor Strange in Spider-Man.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the multiverse first came into play. I mean, we talked about it. We had talked about it before in other movies, but... That's where they first used it.
So, in maybe 10, 12 years ago, Marvel had a series that was, I think it was called Annihilation. And Randy's going to pop in here and tell me that wasn't the name of the actual series. But it was a long time ago now. But let's go, kids, let's go back to the mid-80s.
Okay.
And you have something called Crisis on Infinite Earths with DC Comics. And basically, at the time, what they decided was that the comics were too complicated because there are too many Earths, and they decided that was, for some reason, a problem for new readers, which I have no idea if it was or not. I wasn't quite reading comics at that time. So they collapsed everything down into one Earth. So, Marvel, which is trailing behind the DC universe by about 30 years, maybe more like 25 years, a few years ago, basically, they had a writer and, you know, some artists, and they basically put together Crisis on Infinite Earths for the Marvel U. And so you saw a lot of things that had been happening in there. Unfortunately, Chadwick Boseman has also passed in that time. Because Black Panther is supposed to be one of the members of the Illuminati.
Oh, man.
Yeah. So, the Illuminati is something that is comics accurate, and it was cool to see.
That was Professor my absolute X. favorite part of this movie.
Yeah.
And it was funny, because about 5 minutes before that happened, and I hadn't put it outside the realm of possibility yet, but I was thinking... They're in a multiverse, and they've got all these actors that would come at the drop of a hat. How are we not getting more cameos?
Right.
And then literally 5 minutes later, we start boom, boom, boom. It's like Captain Carter and... what did you say new Captain Marvel's code name is?
Photon?
Photon.
Were they calling her Photon?
I don't think they were. Were they...
I mean, that wasn't her. That was her mom.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, damn. Okay, now I'm really confused. Okay. Anyway.
So the suggestion is, it wasn't Carol who went on that mission.
It was her.
Yeah.
Okay, that went over my head. Sorry, yeah. Movie. And the, which I thought was brilliant casting, with John Krasinski as Reed Richards.
Yeah.
Which I was just, I did a little gasp, and then I did a full, like, vocal gasp when Patrick Stewart came on. Mm-hmm. Because that I was totally not expecting.
Did you hear the X-Men 92 theme?
I did.
Yeah. I love that. I mean, that's
that was my favorite part. I was like, okay, yes, this is taking full advantage of the concept.
Yeah. And Anson Mount returned as Black Bolt, as he had for the Inhumans TV show. And which I think Danny and I are going to do at some point. Because, oh my God, y'all, not the best effort from Marvel. but yeah, it's... I love seeing Hayley Atwell actually suited up.
Oh, like, my God. She got to do action scenes where she, like, had powers and stuff.
Yeah. It was awesome.
Awesome.
And I love, frankly, how Wanda was totally just destroying them, like, left and right as she was going along.
Yeah.
But,
I mean, yeah, I know I've been dissing on her character development this whole movie, but she got to be a badass through the whole thing.
Yeah.
Like, her full powers. Which she can, and she said this in interviews, I'm sure it would be argued by lots of comics nerds, but that she has, like, was the most powerful.
No, comics nerds wouldn't fight that at all.
Okay.
So, the most famous thing Wanda ever did was at the end of this one crisis in the Marvel U, where it had been, like, Magneto fighting everybody who was her dad and whatever. Wanda said, no more mutants. And suddenly, there was only like 100 mutants left on the planet. Like, everyone who'd been powered was depowered, or they didn't remember it, or whatever.
Wow.
So, Wanda can shape reality when push comes to shove, which is why she is wildly dangerous in the comics. Now, I don't really follow Avengers or any of that in the comics. I enjoy the movies much more than the TV shows, but I'm sure if we brought in Jim, he could tell us all about it. But... not my bag. So, but I was aware of that. Like, you couldn't really miss it when it happened. It's a very famous event. So they were kind of referencing that. They were referencing the Illuminati, who were dealing with incursions as they were doing their own crisis. And basically the universe, their multiverse was collapsing, and what did all of that mean? And honestly, I think that story got away from them even more than Crisis. Are they
the equivalent of the Timekeepers?
No.
Okay.
I don't know what you mean by timekeepers.
Well, in the Loki TV show, there was, like, the organization. They weren't called timekeepers. What was it called? What was that organization called? Anyway.
I have no recollection.
But they were in charge of the timeline.
Yeah.
And I was just wondering if these people were in charge of...
The Illuminati are basically in charge of running shit behind the scenes for the planet because weird shit keeps happening.
Okay. So they're not, like, specifically involved in, like, multiverse overlaps.
That's not their entire bag, but they're basically like, if you're running the Big Ten conference, you need to have a Big Ten conference center, which is next to the airport in Chicago, where people can easily fly in and collaborate on things and then go back to whatever they were doing. Same idea.
Okay.
So, yeah, that's kind of what the Illuminati... I mean, they it was one of those things of... They introduced it as, this has always been going on, or has been going on for years, and we just haven't told you, because they're so secret. We haven't even told the audience. So, I really liked that when they did that. I thought that was a really cool idea. I was less of a fan of kind of how their whole incursion thing played out. But... yeah, I mean, it. I don't know if they'll go there with that. It's a really big thing to try and do Crisis. I also think that is kind of DC's thing, and it was a little shitty of Marvel to do it themselves in the comics. But they did it, you know, whatever.
Not the first time they've copied from each other.
No, it is not. Anyway, I think that's basically... I think they're setting up basically the idea of a multiverse. I think long-term, probably Marvel is aware they have to maintain the IP of, like, Thor and Captain America and Iron Man. And sooner or later, they're going to go, here's Earth B, and here's the new Iron Man, and it's young actor who I can't predict at this time. So I think they're thinking of ways to maintain and have like an ultimate Marvel universe or whatever. Mm-hmm. Which they kind of hint at right here with like, you could have like heroes that you kind of know or whatever. I don't know if they'll go down that avenue of, it sells a lot of merch, frankly, if you can sell Captain Carter shirts alongside your Captain America shirts.
Sure.
And people can kind of imagine how cool she is without you really showing a whole lot of her. But it, I think that's basically what this movie was setting itself up to do. It was to kind of wrap up Wanda's storyline for the time being. They can bring her back out anytime they want, say she's good, bad, whatever they want later. She's basically on ice for a while as a character. And hopefully as a character, we'll try and redeem herself, you know, to please the audience. I was kind of curious how the audience would generally feel about the I want my babies side of it. And I mean, it's very much in line with what's in the comics. So one of the interesting things is Sam Raimi, who did Spider-Man in 2002, was a comics nerd growing up. And you could definitely feel the stuff he had a feel for. There's a reason Mount Wundagore's in the movie. Hmm. There's a reason Clea shows up at the very end in the Sting sequence. And I don't know. I don't honestly know if people are like, as a comics person, I was like, yeah, I know what all of this stuff is. I know what the Darkhold is. I know, you know, what. None of this is surprising me as I'm watching it. I'm getting to see it unspool as a film. But for someone who's not familiar, it seems like it was a little more of a problem.
I guess, and this is going to be a retread of what I said in the beginning, but I felt like she had come to peace with that.
Yeah.
The end of WandaVision. And not only that, but she was so focused on, oh, I want to be a mom to these two kids. But there was no mention of Vision whatsoever. Like, there could be Vision in these other multiverses. I just found it odd that he wasn't even mentioned. Like, I don't know if just they couldn't get Paul Bettany, so, and it was too much story already, so they just were like, why bother? But it felt odd.
Yeah, I mean, I think, if nothing else, at the end of WandaVision, when he kind of, white Vision kind of floats away, she's kind of released him. Like, she's let him go to go be dead, for lack of a better way of talking about it. They could continue that story. I don't know what they're going to do. But, yeah, I mean, I don't know. I don't know. I can't predict the future. I'm sorry. It's my limits as a podcaster. As a Sam Raimi movie, I thoroughly enjoyed this movie. Like,
yeah, I mean, you can definitely feel his influence, mm-hmm. especially in fight scenes.
Yeah.
The
way it was shot.
That the music kind of fight at the end was mm-hmm. pretty damn good. Very creative. And the... The Bruce Campbell cameo was just, oh, it was brilliant.
Yeah.
It wasn't too much either. It was just...
I think Sam Raimi came at it of like, oh, I'm going to do a horror movie, you know, like, he did. And
I mean, there's a zombie Doctor Strange.
Yeah, he has Doctor Strange and have it, yeah, a dead corpse, which is kind of a Marvel Zombies thing, but he... I mean, it's the kind of gross stuff he would do in his movies anyway. Yeah.
I mean, like, I hate zombie stuff, but I thought that was pretty funny.
Yeah, it was a good use
of zombies.
Yeah. I liked all this stuff of him, like, harnessing the dark spirits mm-hmm. and, like, using them, like, against Wanda.
Yeah.
I mean, starting off with the giant squid dude.
I loved that guy.
Yeah.
He felt, and I know it's a totally different universe, but he felt like Starro to me.
Yeah.
Just with the giant eye and just kind of like, it's just like a monster. Well, and they don't get to fight stuff like that very often. The last thing I can think of is like the second Guardians movie.
Yeah.
Like, it was like the opening scene from that.
But he got to do a Sam Raimi eye pop in a Marvel movie.
Oh, my God. Yeah, that was so gross, but it was so funny.
but I was like, yeah, this is PG-13, and he just pulled it off because it's an interdimensional monster.
Yeah.
I thought the fight at, I can't even remember the name of their Kathmandu.
Like the ashram place.
Yeah. I thought that was good, but I felt also like we'd just seen it in Shang-Chi.
Yeah.
And I almost to the point of I'm like, they need to find some connection, especially with Wong knowing those characters.
Yeah, I kind of wish they'd used Wong a little better in this. He gets taken out through much of the movie.
Well, it's not Wong.
It's not a Wong movie, I know.
Yeah, he's our new Nick Fury, though. He's the one who appears in all the movies.
That's true.
Yeah.
I mean, I half expected to see Shang-Chi because he had just been recruited.
No, I did too. I like literally was like, are they going to have Shang-Chi show up in this sequence?
I thought they would.
But
not so much.
Yeah, no luck there. But yeah, I mean, I enjoyed the energy of it. I mean, Justin and I are kind of trying to do this Evil Dead series, and I'm sure we'll talk more about it, and we'll have an opportunity to kind of roll back and talk about this movie too. But I feel like Marvel is doing this thing, like they get criticized all the time of all the movies are the same. I'm like, how is this movie anything like point to other? I mean, it does have like, okay, there's another big monster. It's like, but that's like saying that movie has a mom in it. It's like another movie that has a mom in it.
Yeah.
It's like, it's very different from anything else Marvel's done. The feel on it, the tone is, and I don't think it's for everybody. I think that's probably the craziest thing that we're really hitting with Marvel is kind of like Eternals definitely wasn't for everybody. Sam Raimi's not everybody's cup of tea.
I just want to be clear. I know I came off at the beginning of this as if I did not like this movie. I think we've been spoiled by Marvel, to be honest. If I had seen this 20 years ago, and I'm not even talking about the advancements in special effects.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that was part of it, yeah. But it's a very well put together movie. You know, my character beefs aside, I had no problems following it.
Mm-hmm.
It was entertaining, creative.
Yeah.
I enjoyed the cameos. You know, there's a lot to enjoy here.
Yeah.
Where was I going with this, Ryan?
I have no
Crap,
idea.
Crap, I lost my train of thought. I did like it.
Yeah, I mean,
I'll remember later.
I mean, you kind of get lost in all the special effects and all that, but I was like, in the middle of all this, there is a story about Stephen Strange realizing it doesn't matter what reality he's in, he wasn't going to be with Christine because all of the Stephen Stranges have the same flaws.
Right.
It doesn't matter if they're an evil Stephen Strange or whether they're, you know, compromised or, you know, have a ponytail. All of them, in him having that realization kind of about himself so he can let it go and move on, which I think is also crucial. Like if Christine is not going to be... I keep wanting to, by the way, call her Rachel because of her real name.
Well, but at least you know her real name now.
Yeah, I know. But they can move on from that character. I mean, Clea has really been the love interest in the comics since I was a kid. Like, I
never felt a really strong attachment to them anyway.
Yeah.
So I'm not crushed by that.
It has the vibe of like a lot of like when they'd make a sequel to a movie in the 80s of like there would be a love interest in the first movie and be like, yeah, I really like that character. And they'd be like, what about their girlfriend? You're like, oh yeah, they had a girlfriend. Like that's kind of how I felt about Christine in the first Doctor Strange.
Yeah.
It's like, it's way more interesting when he gets to hang out with Tilda Swinton and Wong.
But they used her really well in this.
I thought, and that's kind of the cool thing about it, right? Is she gets to kind of play the same character in these different perspectives and gets to do things, but also have the moment with him in this really interesting thing of, well, I saw you die, you know, in this world, and it's just never going to work, right?
Yeah.
And so they do work in some of the personal stuff, and it doesn't feel cheesy. It didn't feel like the music's going to swell and we're going to have this realization and a single tear will roll down Stephen Strange's face.
I don't feel like that's Marvel's bag, though. They've never really leaned heavily into that.
No. But I also think Sam Raimi knows what he's doing.
He does. Yeah. And I think he's definitely done romance before.
Yeah. And I think that's
effectively.
He's Spider-Man.
Yeah.
So I was kind of impressed with how that went for all the other stuff too. I felt like the Wanda stuff to me, because I knew, I guess, she was going to go bad. I know Wanda from the comics. I knew she was going to be a problem. But yeah, and just kind of otherwise becomes this journey of like, look, Marvel has this whole other, you know, universe that we might be playing with at, you know, other times. And
I guess if I had anything that I wish they had explored more, it would have been, we really only got to see like one other universe, I think. I can't remember if they landed in another one. The sequence in which they were jumping between universes was really, really well done. And I don't expect them
I was cackling audibly during that whole sequence.
I don't expect them to spend, you know, any real amount of time in all of them, but the one that they landed in, it felt like, oh, well, it's different because the red means green and there are pizza balls. Like, I wish they had pushed that just a little further. And I know that's not the point of the movie, but you know, I wish they had done that.
Yeah, well, once you open the door, it starts raising all those questions.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't blame you.
Yeah. It would have been cute, but
yeah,
I could do without it.
But again, how long was the movie? It was 2 hours. It's like, what where are you going to spend your time?
Hey, Endgame was 3 hours.
Yeah.
This has been the shortest movie they've done in a long time.
Yeah, but I don't think that's necessarily wrong. But the funny thing about that is, you know, I read that interview whenever, like a year ago, with someone who worked at Marvel, and they were like, why are Marvel movies so long? And the answer was, because everybody wants every question answered.
Yeah.
If you introduce an idea, you have to pursue it to the end. Yeah, that's exactly what you're doing, Jamie.
No, but I think you can do...
You want to know if hot dogs are a sandwich in another universe.
You can have stuff in the background and not have it take up screen time. Like
they did.
All over the place.
Yeah. Okay.
No, I mean, I know what you mean. It would have been interesting to do either more universes or explore more about that universe. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. It means I wanted more of a good thing.
Yeah, that's not...
It's not bad.
Yeah. But yeah, I don't have like a lot to say. It's kind of like the other Doctor Strange movie. It's big, it's splashy. As far as Benedict Cumberbatch's portrayal as Doctor Strange, I think I'm more on board with it than you are. I find his like cool, dry wit in the face of, or his tendency just to sound like a dad sometimes, going like, "Ah, shit," as like the world's exploding in his face, like with demons and, you know, whatever. To be kind of charming. Like, that's not necessarily the take that was in the comics when I was a kid.
Yeah.
It was much more of like, by the eye of Agaroth, and, you know, and
I mean,
I'm doing the Doctor Strange hand gestures here on the side of the microphone.
I do like what he does with the character. It just... And maybe that's it. Maybe because there is, it's missing that emotional element from him, which I just said I didn't need. I don't know. I don't know why, like, Captain America draws me in more than he does.
Yeah. No, I mean, fair is fair.
Yeah.
I mean, they do more to build up Steve. I mean, that's First Avenger, right? I mean, the movie, I was rewatching the original Doctor Strange, and I was kind of shocked how far you are into the movie before really he starts, like, heading off to Kathmandu or whatever. It's pretty far along, and they take a while to kind of tease out all the ideas, because it's a lot. When you're reading comics as a kid, you have, you know, 22, 24 pages in the, you know, now it's like 20, but, and there were all these text blocks explaining everything on every panel of, like, you know, they'd be like, oh, you have the Darkhold, and there'd be like this thing, like either someone in a thought bubble would be going, here's what it is, kids, or
it's an asterisk with like Stan Lee's explanation, see this copy of blah blah blah.
Exactly. And you don't have that in the movies, and it does create this kind of need to kind of explain everything. It's a lot when you start getting into like sorcerer fights. I will say, I really like this stuff in Doctor Strange, the first one. I said earlier, like, this one's totally different with what they did with it, and it's some shocking creativity that I think they showed. Like, I felt like they sat down and said, okay, a lot of these movies end up with, like, I hate to say Wonder Woman, the first one, but like the last 15 minutes of Wonder Woman,
not good. Yeah. I love that movie, and the last 15 minutes are very disappointing.
Yeah, it's like, here's a whole bunch of bright lights and people going, no. And you're like,
fight mustache man now.
I mean, it's kind of end of Rise of Skywalker. Like, I know a bunch of shit happened at the end of that movie.
I've only seen that once.
Yeah, but it was like, I see lightsabers and flashing lightning, and I'm not really sure what's going on. Oh, there went some ghosts, I think.
This one you concretely understand
what the magic is visually doing.
Yeah. And it was wholly satisfying to me that America saved the day by showing Wanda what would really happen if she did this.
Yeah.
I mean, but also I will say I could see that from the very beginning. Like, I could guess, because Wanda is technically this nebulous good guy, bad guy now. Mm-hmm. She was going to have to solve this problem because she is the most powerful one and she has the capability and humanity to see that what she's doing is wrong. Yeah. So I was able to see, this is how this is going to resolve. But it didn't. That didn't ruin it for me. Mm-hmm. I found it satisfying.
Yeah. On America Chavez, I don't know anything about her in the comics. Like, zilch, zero, whatever. I knew she jumped between dimensions, but that was all I knew.
I think I thought her character was supposed to be a lot older than she was supposed to be.
How old is she supposed to be?
I think the actress was like 13 when she auditioned. I don't know how old she was when they filmed, but I thought she was like 17 or something. I don't know. I'm terrible at telling ages.
Everyone under 30 looks like they're 12 to me now. So I have no idea.
Yeah. But it made a lot more sense with how much they were kind of babysitting her. And yeah, she just didn't know how to use her powers, and they were powerful. But
I thought she was supposed to be concurrent with Kamala Khan.
Me too. Yeah, who's like 16, 17.
Okay. Yeah, I guess that's right.
Yeah.
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 But yeah, I liked what they did with the visuals, with the character, like the over-the-top star punch and all that stuff.
Yeah, I thought
the little actress
was... just going to say that her visualization of her opening a portal to another, the little star, mm-hmm. that looked really cool.
Yeah. We've seen enough circles, damn it.
Yeah.
we need squares. We need trapezoids.
Yeah.
Is a trapezoid a square?
I don't know. But I also thought, like, the inner, it's not inner sanctum, because that's like the name of
a record store. Well, the Sanctum Sanctorum?
Yeah. But the spaces in between the universes, that space was really cool as well.
Yeah. Yeah. That's kind of, it's so funny, like, how the different, like, so there's always the multiverse, and then the Authority came out as a comic, which was not a DC comic until they got bought by DC. They were Wildstorm was its own thing. But they went, when they didn't want anybody tracking them, they went to the Bleed, which was, that was air quotes, the space between dimensions. And now that's a thing in DC, the DC universe. Yeah,
I've heard that term before. In some comic I read, I've seen that term.
Yeah, they just went ahead and just adopted it and pulled it in with the rest of the Authority stuff.
I hate to say this, but I think it was the Smallville comic.
That's fine. I don't care. But yeah, the Smallville comics were better than a few of the seasons of the show. So
100% shame there.
Absolutely. But yeah, but it was interesting to see Marvel also playing with that idea and their own multiverse stuff. But at the same time, it's just kind of like, oh man, y'all, like, you're so far ahead of DC on all this stuff. DC's just absolutely flailing. Their attempt to do their multiverse thing was supposed to be coming with The Flash, which has been delayed and delayed, and now Ezra Miller's gone off the rails, yeah. And who knows if they can even release it at this point. I mean, my guess is it'll get dumped to HBO Max, and they'll have to do a lot of apologizing to a lot of talent. But, I mean, maybe people will show up at the theater to see it, but it's going to get raked over the coals for just existing at this point. Which is crazy, because that movie was in development for like 5 years, maybe longer.
Yeah.
And then they finally shot
it. Yeah, it feels like I've been hearing about it for a very long time. I saw
the shots of the girl who's playing Supergirl, I think pre-COVID.
Oh my God.
Like, that's how long ago, like, all of this was, like, being worked on. So, Marvel done got way ahead of DC on everything.
Everything.
So, anyway, I know this movie's a little divisive. People have been a little dismissive of it. But
it was okay.
Yeah, I thought
it was entertaining.
It's kind of like when we watched Eternals. Like, I liked it, I think, a lot better than you did.
I liked this better than Eternals.
Yeah, I'm not shocked.
Yeah. Probably just because they were like, I was sitting there going, "Oh, that character, I know that person in Eternals, it's a bunch of people I didn't know."
Yeah.
And was not easily connecting with.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. At least you know Doctor Strange. And they did do callbacks to some of the other stuff of, like, they kept asking him, was it really the one way to
fight Thanos? It's a good question, though.
I mean, they talked about the blip and, you know, so I'm glad to know none of that got dropped I know I've said this 10 times on the podcast at this point, but I really thought when they did the blip, I was like, what are you guys doing?
Just created so many problems, and then...
But they're actually addressing it, sort of. Kind of.
Yeah. They've been kind of footnotes.
Yeah. I definitely want to see the story of the person who married somebody else whose spouse came back.
Oh, God. Like, I don't. That's terrible.
Of course it's terrible. But that's the people who moved into a house, and then the people are like, we're back.
Oh God, this the courts would be tied up for years.
Well, I mean, and people forget that was the whole story of Falcon and the Winter Soldier.
Yeah, that's true.
And yeah, people have already forgotten and dismissed that as not being exactly what they wanted. I was like, that was a good show, y'all. Anyway, I don't really have anything else to say on Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness. I do think it will be interesting to see we have a lot of things in play between there's an Illuminati out there. We have the idea introduced. We'll see if it ever comes up again. We have the incursions definitely introduced. That could play in both with time and space with Loki and Kang, who was introduced in that. The thing no one's talking about is last we saw Nick Fury, he was flying through space, and we definitely have not forgotten that there's Skrulls and Kree out
there. Right.
And so there's a lot of different things that still need to happen in the Marvel U that can potentially happen, but they're definitely churning through some of their bigger events. I'm not sure we're quite ready to do Evolutionary War for you who are there in summer of 88 with me, or whatever that was. But and certainly it seemed an opportunity to start thinking about introducing the X-Men. I will say, I flat out don't want the X-Men in the current MCU. Like, that has to be a completely different...
I'd be fine multiverse. If it was its own thing, if
Marvel
was in charge of it.
Yeah, well, they are. Yeah. It's all Disney now, man.
And we don't get another Return to Fantastic Four or whatever. But no, not Fantastic Four. I'm sorry. I was thinking of all of the subsequent X-Men movies after X-Men 2.
Oh, yeah. You mean X3.
Well, but then there have been lots of, like, Apocalypse and...
X-Men Go West. yeah. It's... that kind of farted its way out of existence. I say that. Logan was amazing.
It was.
That... couldn't should have been the end. All right, well, that's all I can say on
I'm all done.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks for hanging with us and join us for more Marvel Madness.
We might someday get to see Thor.
Thor.
Which I'm dying to see, but I don't want to risk COVID right now.
Yeah.
Still.
Yeah, we'll mask up.
In year three.
Jamie can't go to movies.
I can't.
Ryan can't go to movies if you don't wear your mask and get back. So please do. All right. Y'all have a good one.
Bye.
That about wraps it up for this edition of The Signal Watch, a production of the League of Melbotus. Thanks for sticking with us. If you enjoyed the podcast, we invite you to drop on by the Signal Watch blog, where you'll find write-ups of a wide variety of movies and more. We'd love to hear from you, so find us online and let us know what you think. Whether you prefer email, blog comments, or social media, we'll be happy to hear from you. We'll be back soon with more exceedingly high-quality content. So, until next time, God damn it, babies, you've got to be kind.